Today's episode is brought to you by engineering.com, a globally trusted source for engineering content. Check out this and many other exclusive videos for the engineering professional found only on engineering.com TV today. Welcome to The Primary Loop. I'm Jim Anderton, Multimedia Content Director here at engineering.com. You know, photochemical etching has been around for decades as an engineering technology to create fine structures. It's conceptually simple. Impress an image of the desired structure on a metal substrate using inks or coatings that are chemically resistant, then immerse the entire substrate in a strong etchant that will dissolve away unwanted material, leaving behind a high resolution and complex part that can be extremely small. Now, as a micromachining technology, it can do a lot more than just manufacture watch springs. And to discuss this interesting technology and advanced applications, I'm joined by Karl Martinson, Director of Business Development North America for the Micrometal Etching Group of Baden, Germany-based Vicader Westfalen. Karl, welcome to The Primary Loop.
Thanks, Jim. Glad to be here.
Karl, it's to begin with, photochemical etching done there. We know it's been done for a long time for making certain types of very precision small parts. Tell me, how does it work exactly down there? If I'm a design engineer, I need a very, very tiny precision component.
Sure. Well, your initial description was pretty accurate, but it's actually come a long way since then, too. Instead of just immersing a material in etchant, really what it's come to now is doing a very precision application of a photoresist layer on two sides of either a metal sheet or a coil, and then imaging a high resolution photomask over that photoresist using ultraviolet light. So the higher the resolution on the photomask, the better resolution you have of the image on the photoresist. That is then exposed to ultraviolet light, which hardens any area of the photoresist that is exposed to that. Anything that is blocked by the photomask tool is not hardened and not resistant to chemicals. So basically you have a reverse image of what you want to create at the end of the day. And then rather than just a pure immersion of that coated metal in an etchant substrate, it can be sprayed under different variations of temperature and pressure from both sides so that you really are truly chemically milling away the material that you don't want to be there, leaving only what you want left.
Wow. Now, it's chemical milling, of course, is a commonly used sort of expression for this technology as well. Now, it sounds a bit like the technology used for making computer chips.
It's actually where most people associate when they say they know something about photochemical etching. That's the first thing they think of is the semiconductor industry. And really what it has gone from just making watch springs and things like that into an area of really, really high precision components in thin metal up to about a millimeter or so in thickness. But the advancements of what you can do with that technology has allowed it to make things for medical instrumentation, for the automotive industry, for consumer goods. The precision and the complexity that you can design into a photochemically etched metal component right now it's just taken leaps and bounds over the last decade or so.
Yeah. Karl, can you give us a sense of scale in the sense of how small can you make components with this technology and what kind of resolution are we looking at?
Well, my company personally makes a lot of really, really small components or micro screens, things like that, or micro needles for medical applications. We can get down to a level where the smallest feature size we can etch is about 80% of the material thickness. So for instance, if you're working with 50 micron thick material, we can actually put a 35 micron hole in that, or a slot or any type of feature that you'd like with very thin web widths between them. So it's pretty small scale. We're working usually in tens of microns, maybe a couple hundred microns at a scale, but it's scalable up to very large parts as well. It just really depends on where you want to take it. And that's when you start looking at economies of scale versus other technologies. But from a design flexibility standpoint, there's nothing out there that can make features as small as a high precision photochemically etched part.
Yep. Yeah. And how many parts typically would you make in a single run? I mean, these parts are incredibly tiny, but what if I need 1,000 of them?
It's one of the other beauties about this particular technology is you can go from making two parts to 20 million parts, depending on the type of etch line that you have or whatever. And the tooling is the same, no matter what. Prototyping is the same. So you can go from prototype, then you can basically scale that tool up at a very low cost and make 20, 30, 40, 50 million parts on a line. And the great thing about it is no difference between a prototype and a finished part. The 20 millionth part is going to be identical to that of the prototype.
Yeah. Now you mentioned medical applications. Medical applications, I always think of, you know, the 304, 306 series stainless, you know, the classic sort of you know, surgical materials in there. What kind of materials do you work with?
Well, those materials you just mentioned are favorites across the industry. They just etch very well, but really the options are almost limitless. Any type of metal that can be dissolved by some sort of chemical is fine. We can work with titanium, aluminum, nickel, silver, copper, clad materials. So you can work with different levels of clad materials, molybdenum, gold. It's really limitless as long as you can get the right etchant and you can find a photoresist that will resist those particular chemicals.
Yeah. Yep. What was your most difficult application or your most challenging application?
I would say probably in trying to work out the details on a very, very sharp microneedle for a medical application where the part was very, very small, less than a half a millimeter in width and maybe about 10 millimeters long. And we had to try to find a way to put an extremely sharp edge, sharp tip on it, and then also be able to etch some sort of 3D structures into the sides and thickness so that the customer could attach a sensor to that. Now, this is all on a scale of microns rather than millimeters in general as far as these feature sizes. And that one took a lot of back and forth and some tries, but nailed the process down, and it's a successful product to this day.
Yeah. Is part handling a challenge? You're talking about component parts where you're talking about microns. I'm imagining that, you know, electrostatics could be a factor. I mean, you can't just reach in there with a pair of tweezers and yank these things out, can you?
No, there's some special tooling required, especially if you want to separate these parts from that etch sheet independently. Now, most of the time when you're etching, there is a small retention tab that will hold the part itself in a larger sheet or in a coil. For instance, with reel-to-reel etching, you put raw material in, the raw coil of material, and you have complete strips of etched parts coming out that are still retained in that strip with a small retention tab. What that's great for is being able to integrate that finished part without ever having touched it. You put it through a vision inspection system, you can validate the quality of the part, and then that goes right back onto another reel, or if it's a sheet process, can be stacked in sheets with separators. Those can then be put into an automated downstream system, such as punching the part out or forming it or doing an integration into some sort of subassembly, but the parts are rarely touched by human hands. You can keep the entire process automated as much as possible.
Yeah. Karl, in engineering design, of course, there's the part that the designer wants to design, and there's a part that manufacturing processes can actually deliver. And sometimes getting those two concepts to sort of converge can be pretty challenging. When a design engineer wants a very, very small part, a precision part like this, what's the logical process? Should they reach out to people like you first before they lock a design in at this point? Or it's how do they learn about photochemical etching and what it can do?
Well, first of all, we learn about photochemical etching through you and having this type of interview. But yeah, we do want people to reach out to us. And it's kind of a missionary effort because typically when someone wants a small metal part, they immediately go to laser cutting or stamping or something because that's what they're familiar with. And etching is not a really well-recognized technology in the industry, even though it's been around, as you said, for decades. So we want to get the message out there that there's a lot of design freedom that's available through the things that we just talked about, being able to etch in different orientations, top to bottom of the material. You're not just punching something straight through. We can do many different configurations. You can have in one strip or one part, you can have partial depth etch features combined with through features. So you can even put a part number partially etched or something into the surface while you're actually creating through features and things as well. So there's just so much design freedom that exists in etching that most engineers aren't aware of. As I said, their brain just goes to stamping or laser cutting and they don't really understand what they can do. It's, as you mentioned, it's what they think they can do based on the technology that they understand. So the effort here is to try to make sure that engineers really understand the technology that's out there and get that light bulb to go on over your head. We say, I didn't know I could do that. And then they run back and start trying to design what they really want, not just what they think they can get.
And I think we just started that process. Karl Martinson, Micrometal, thanks for joining me on The Primary Loop.
My pleasure. Great to be with you, Jim.
Well, that's it for this episode of The Primary Loop, brought to you by Engineering.com. For our deeper engineering series, visit Engineering.com TV for exclusive shows like Manufacturing the Future, Designing the Future, and The Engineering Roundtable, not found here on our YouTube channel. The links are in the description below. Thanks for watching.